I'm Brendan Shanahan of the National Hockey League's Department of Player Safety. Throughout the season, we will provide video examples of both legal hockey plays and illegal plays that rise to the level of supplemental discipline. We hope to give players, clubs, and fans a better feel for how the league views such plays. We work within the rules and interpretations of the NHL rulebook. Our mandate is not necessarily to judge if an infraction is a penalty, but to determine the degree, and then decide whether additional discipline may be required. Although no two plays are ever exactly alike, these examples should serve as reference points and guidelines for similar plays. These videos will be available for all to view on NHL.com. In this video, we will look at various plays that occur along the boards and how they relate to each other. These are examples of when players who are about to be checked initiate a counter hit or reverse hit in order to either protect themselves or gain a puck possession advantage.
Perron, an outlet, and Polak to work to get it over the center ice line and in. Oshie goes down as he tried to run into Brent Burns.
Just prior to absorbing contact, Brent Burns surprises the checker, in this case TJ Oshie, and delivers an effective reverse hit.
Rasico, who makes his home in Florida, is a pretty prolific hockey player in his own right, playing junior.
Ooh, what a
hit there.
Fought off the crossbar.
Francis Bouillon also takes a proactive approach. He beats Derek Dorsett to the punch and avoids being checked into the boards.
Then, under a lot of pressure, Healy picks up and sends the puck wide to the short side with Rene well out of the net. Coyle has it back again.
In this example, Francis Bouillon receives a reverse check from Mikko Koivu.
Zetterberg knew it. Koivu shoots it. Blocked. On Koivu. Knocked down Cromwell. Koivu back in front. Sanaguchi scores. The game's over.
Very similar to the last example on Bouillon, this time Koivu turns the tables on Nicholas Cromwell, making significant contact to Cromwell with his back. Similar to the plays we just watched, these are examples where a player, either in an attempt to reverse hit or simply use body contact to lean back and protect the puck, has initiated contact but lost the physical battle. It's important to note that on each of these plays, the hitter did not excessively take advantage of his physical and territorial advantage near the boards simply because contact was initiated against him. It was our view that the contact was still minimized to an acceptable degree.
I think right now it's just, they're really fighting it right now, so I think when that happens is you got to simplify and you got to just chip pucks in, get your legs into it. What a hit by Chara on Giroux.
And here comes Van Riemsdyk, the challenge of
Tim Thomas in the right wing corner. There, Claude Giroux kind of doesn't go in and get that puck first. He initiates body contact with Zdeno Chara. He almost tried to brace for the hit before Chara got to him, and all Chara did was just push him a little bit. But it seemed to me that Giroux was the one that initiated the contact instead of going in for that puck first.
Green, of all people, really, I think that really added it, you know, to really rub it in for St. Louis. They knew they had missed all on the play. Oh, big hit.
Mitchell takes that Langenbrunner. There was a penalty coming, and now Nickel is getting involved with Richardson away from where Langenbrunner and Mitchell were.
Here's the hit by Willie Mitchell on Langenbrunner, and yeah, it's a tough hit for Langenbrunner. He does get injured, but you know what? Willie Mitchell held up. He actually put an arm around him, and he takes him in hard, but he didn't punish him the way we've seen an awful lot of times. He gets 2 minutes for boarding. I don't have a problem with that.
Got them blocked. Dropped it. Cole shot it. Oh, what a save! A redirect and a best save of the game for Corey Crawford. Now a penalty to Boca. He knocked down Kruger from behind. Blues are going to be shorthanded again.
Well, you saw Patrick Sharp there, Pat. He stops anticipating the hit from Vladimir Sobotka. Almost like Sharpie initiated the contact and he took the worst of it. Watch this. Watch Sharp's left shoulder. He stops. He goes in to make the hit and he takes the worst of it. It was almost he put himself in that position. If Sharpie doesn't initiate the contact, then for sure.
Occasionally, a player will put his hand on his opponent's back as a way of letting him know that he is behind him and in close proximity, most often while both players approach the boards. The next few examples are of players putting their hand on their opponent's back just prior to a fall. However, in spite of a hand on the back and a penalty being called, we determined that there was no push and therefore did not warrant supplemental discipline.
The first penalty killers for the Blue Jackets. Lidstrom feathered it in. Zetterberg's going to the box.
This is unfortunate, but he never touched the guy.
He didn't mean to do it, but he's going to go to the box on a play like that. Nikitin went down.
Oh, that's terrible.
He's going to be from behind with the stick in there.
His left foot.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, there was an injury to Nikitin on this play. But when we interviewed the Blue Jackets after the game, they confirmed what we believed, that Nikitin's left foot got caught in a rut in the ice while he was trying to change direction, causing him to fall violently into the boards. There was no supplemental discipline, and Zetterberg's major penalty was rescinded.
Anton Lander with Leonard Petrell. Flips it in, 20 seconds to go. Penalty on the way. Zydlitski got taken into the boards by Petrell.
That was ugly. And just the left arm, Kevin, of Leonard Petrell just kind of gave Zydlitski a little shove as he was going in. Good to see that he's up in aware position. He's going to get a 5-minute major for this and a game misconduct. And again, this is a common play and something that you're seeing them really bear down on and call.
While there has never been more responsibility placed on the player delivering a check, the boarding rule still acknowledges that there is still responsibility on the player getting hit, not to make himself vulnerable by turning just prior or simultaneously with an oncoming check. While some of these examples were still called penalties, the Department of Player Safety did not pursue supplemental discipline due to the fact that the player receiving the check turned just prior to contact, similar to other non-suspensions for contact against the boards. Not only did we consider the turning just prior from the player being hit, but also whether or not, in our opinion, the player delivering the check had minimized the contact as much as possible under the circumstances, or whether he took advantage of the situation and exploded through the check with significant force.
Lucic has this knocked off his stick by Bogosian. Stewart gets rammed into the boards by Krejci.
David Krejci in on the forecheck. Mark Stewart sees him coming, looks to turn and protect the puck. David Krejci gives him a bump in from behind.
Chimera on the way in, and oh, he just takes an incredibly long run at Adam McQuaid.
Chimera's going to try to argue that McQuaid put himself in a vulnerable position when he got to this puck. Because he pivots like that is why Chimera is saying, I'm not at fault here.
It goes to Heatley. For Bouchard behind the net gets drilled into the penalty coming to Zach Bogosian. Caught him in a vulnerable spot. It wasn't that aggressive of a hit.
Here's Dustin Brown with it. And his stick chopped out of his hand. Oh, the penalty now being called. Referee at center ice put his hand up late.
Doan's coming at him, and he's facing Doan. Why would he turn and put himself in that position and face the boards at the last second?
The following are examples where we felt supplemental discipline was required.
Doing that is Stoll.
Did you see the last shot from the point there? Two guys went down. They're two star players, Richards and Kopitar, trying to block it.
Oshie run into by Doughty, and more going on with 1.1 to go.
Trying to get down and block the shot, and then here's Doughty. Oh, yeah, that's a tough hit. Because he's about 5 feet away from the boards, he's just going for the puck, and it is a cross check across the back. That is a violent collision. The league will definitely be looking at that one.
A lot of people, including the goaltender, had no idea where the puck was. It was high on the body of Gil.
There's Doughty, nice move, right side, goes in deep. Kept there by Lars Eller, hard into the boards, and a penalty to Eller.
Cross checking motion where the cross check wasn't that bad, but it's that shove at the last second. And we've seen it called against the Kings a couple times this year.
The next four examples are boarding suspensions.
As the video shows,
Gomez chips the puck back behind the net to his right as Myers approaches him from behind. Looking directly at Gomez's back, Myers hits Gomez from behind, causing him to crash violently into the boards. At no point during Myers' approach to the check does he see anything other than Gomez's back. The onus, therefore, is upon Myers to avoid this hit completely, or at the very least, minimize it.
At 11:14 of the first period, St. Louis forward Chris Stewart shoved Detroit defenseman Nicholas Cronwell from behind and into the boards. As the video shows, Stewart is directly behind Cronwell and sees his numbers for some time. On the play, once Cronwell is alerted by his bench and recognizes that Stewart is on his heels, Cronwell slightly veers to his right in an effort to shield the puck. At this point, he is bracing for impact. This does not appear to us to be an attempt to reverse hit Stewart, and it is our opinion that Cronwell's movement does not contribute significantly to the violent collision with the boards that results from the shove from behind by Stewart. With that being said, the onus is on Stewart to avoid this hit completely, or at the very least, minimize it. At 11:01 of the third period, Phoenix forward Martin Hanzel was assessed a major penalty and game misconduct for boarding Los Angeles forward Dustin Brown. After Brown chips the puck deep at the Phoenix blue line, he pursues the puck with Hanzel behind him. After skating behind Brown for some distance, Hanzel finishes Brown forcefully and at a very dangerous distance from the boards. There are occasions when both players initiate contact with a bump or a hit prior to reaching a loose puck in order to gain better body position. There also are times when a player who already has body position tries to reverse hit his opponent, loses the physical battle, and goes into the boards awkwardly. This is neither of those cases. Hanzel is directly behind Brown and his vision is focused on Brown. Hanzel then recklessly initiates the check from behind into the boards. He does not avoid contact, and he does not attempt to minimize it. As the video shows, Carcillo chips the puck behind Gilbert at the Edmonton blue line, creating a race toward the end boards. This is a 50-50 puck that either player can win, and in such cases, a reasonable amount of physical contact is permissible as the players jostle for position. However, on this play, Carcillo slows up and gets behind Gilbert. Just as Gilbert begins slowing down and bracing himself for some contact, Carcillo explodes into him, causing a violent crash into the boards. Not only does Carcillo not minimize contact, he hits Gilbert into the boards with tremendous force. Also, this is not a case of two players bumping each other for position and one player winning that battle, nor is it a play in which Gilbert loses balance after initiating a reverse hit.